fancy. Mine doesn't have 5 minutes left.
Really? Ooh.
And you all know Lisa?
That's your...
Yes.
Yeah. Well, there's more.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to the closing session. How's everyone doing? Good, 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 good. So it's been an amazing couple of days, and I just wanted to thank everyone again for coming. Just a reminder that after this panel, we will be having a party at the center on 13th Street. So just a quick walk over where we will have food and drinks and a lovely time just to close out the wonderful conference that we've had so far. So I have the honor of moderating this final panel. This final panel is an opportunity for people to reflect not only on their experiences throughout the past couple of days, but also just to reflect on the impact of Jonathan Nedcatz's work on their own respective works and careers and experiences. So I'm just going to briefly introduce our panelists. Each panelist is going to speak for about 15 minutes, and then we want it to be more of a casual conversation where people can share and reflect and audience members can participate, and we can have a great end to the conference. So I am joined by John D'Amelio, who retired in 2014, continues to research write about the U.S. since World War II. Social movements and the history of sexuality. Feel free to cheer. He's a pioneer in the field of gay and lesbian studies, the author and editor of more than half a dozen books, including Sexual Politics, Sexual Communities, The Making of Homosexual Minority in the United States, Intimate Matters, A History of Sexuality in America with Estelle Friedman, Lost Prophet, The Life and Times of Bayard Rustin, a National Book Award finalist, and The World Turned, Essays on Gay History, Politics, and Culture. An expanded 25th anniversary, third edition of Intimate Matters is slated for publication, or it did come out for publication in January 2013. Next up, we have Carol Vance. Well, actually, wrong order. We have Esther Newton is next. Esther is a term professor of American culture and women's studies at the University of Michigan. She's also a professor of anthropology and Kempner Distinguished Professor Emerita of Emerita at Purchase College SUNY. She was a founder of the Lesbian and Gay Studies program at Purchase College, the author of numerous articles, and of Mother Camp, Female Impersonators in America, yeah. Cherry Grove, Fire Island, 60 Years in America's First Gay and Lesbian Town, and Margaret Mead Made Me Gay, Personal Essays, Public Ideas.
Yay.
The last two won the Ruth Benedict Award of the Society of Lesbian and Gay Anthropologists of the American Anthropological Association. Her next project is a memoir, My Butch Career, and she's a Michigan alumna. Next up, we have Carol Vance. Carol is a professor of anthropology at Columbia University, where she teaches and writes about sexuality, human rights, science, gender, and health. She coordinated the landmark Barnard Conference on Sexuality and edited Pleasure and Danger. Pleasure and Danger, Exploring Female Sexuality. Dr. Vance's recent work focuses on trafficking into forced prostitution, issues of consent and state regulation, and the current Title IX initiatives to stop sexual violence on U.S. campuses. Vance has received the David R. Kessler Award and Simon and Gagnon Award for contributions to sexuality studies. And finally, we have Jonathan Nedcatz.
Woo.
And I think... So Jonathan, I think instead of giving his formal bio, I think everyone will give their own perspectives and their bios, and I'm sure everyone has their own thoughts about how much Jonathan has contributed to our world. So I'll allow them to all introduce him, but please give a big round of applause for Jonathan Nedcatz, as well as to our other panelists today. Okay, so we have a couple of hours slated for this, and each person is going to go for 15 minutes, and then we can have a nice conversation. We don't have to use the full 2 hours in case people want to rush to eat and drink, which we might need to do after a wonderful conference. So I'm going to first leave it up to John to start, and we'll go from there.
Okay. So, well, let me just begin by admitting, being honest, my remarks are going to be unabashedly personal reminiscence, right? So no deep scholarships coming from me today. But I will start by saying, you know, like, as a historian, I think that what I'm always aiming for in what I write is what I describe as truthful statements. Truthful. The truthful statement that I'll begin my remarks today is this. The day I met Jonathan was the day my life changed forever. Completely true statement. It was March 1973. I was a second year graduate student at Columbia, still taking courses. I was studying U.S. history out of a desire to expose the evils of corporate capitalism and American imperialism. At that point, I was pretty sure I was going to write a dissertation on how corporate liberals had created the Cold War. And in March 1973, I had gotten invited to a Saturday afternoon meeting at an apartment on the Upper East Side. It turned out at the meeting there were 7 or 8 white guys and 1 white woman. And the purpose of the meeting, as it was had been described to me, is that we were going to discuss how our research and writing skills might contribute to the gay liberation movement. And at that point in my life, I was socially and sexually gay. I had a boyfriend that I lived with, I had a gay social circle, but I had never been involved with or connected to any kind of queer activism, never been to a meeting, never been to a demonstration, rally, anything. And so it was incredibly exciting to me. Suddenly, my desire to learn history and use it as a tool for social change and movement building now was potentially going to connect to this other core part of my life. And I'll say, to sort of jump ahead, that the excitement that I experienced about that first meeting was apparently exciting to lots of other people too, because that first meeting led to dozens more meetings, led to creating an organization that year called the Gay Academic Union, to organizing large national conferences, and lots more too. There were a lot of spin-offs that came from the networks that were created at that period through the Gay Academic Union. But this desire to do research that would spur the gay liberation movement forward may have been very exciting, but it was also pretty abstract, except for one person who was sitting in that room who was already doing it, and that person was Jonathan Katz. And he wasn't just doing research, you know, I mean, think of all the things you could research. He was doing U.S. history research. I'm a U.S. history graduate student. Oh, my God. And Jonathan, already at that first meeting, Jonathan was able to talk about what he was finding. His preliminary research had already come together in a play, Coming Out. And it wasn't too long after this that I got to see a performance of the play in the Village. It was thrilling. It was mind-blowing. I'd never seen anything like it. It was unimaginable that these dramatic performances were actually living documents that were being spoken. And it's like, oh my God, you know, this is what's ahead. And watching the play only made, when I finally saw it, only made realer the fact that Jonathan was moving beyond the play at that point. He already had a vision for what was to become gay American history and was deep into the research. So at the most basic level, It was Jonathan who let me know that this was a possibility. Jonathan, who opened my eyes to what has really remained at the center of my life and my work for more than 40 years now. And so to describe it as visionary and life-altering is in no way an exaggeration. But then the other thing about Jonathan and about what he meant to me is that it wasn't just a vision that he had, it was also very concrete and specific. Because Jonathan, and I'm sure I'm not the only person who is capable of saying this, Jonathan is among the most generous human beings I have ever known. He was, yes, he, from that point, from the time I met him, he was always willing to share his work. He was always looking for feedback on his work. He was always willing to present work in progress that wasn't yet finished and perfect. And he was always willing to be helpful. And for instance, to make it concrete, at this point now in our ongoing relationship, I was moving in the direction of the dissertation that became Sexual Politics, Sexual Communities. At that time in the 1970s, it was a journey into the unknown. And Jonathan was generous to the nth degree. Even though Gay American History had not yet been published, actually at this point it was not even yet in press. I mean, it was going to be published, but it wasn't like, you know, out there. He shared with me the interviews that he had done with Harry Hay and Barbara Giddings and Randy Wicker. The interview with Hay, of course, was especially exciting. The discovery that the early gay movement in the U.S. was in an important sense started by a group of men with connections to the Communist Party. How amazing is that? Like, are you making this up? Was he lying to you in that interview, you know? And so it just opened up a completely unexpected world of connections between a queer politics and the history of the left in the United States that I think very few, if any of us, had an idea of at that point. You know, we couldn't have even imagined it. Then there was Gay American History itself, the anticipation of it, the impact, the originality and innovativeness of its design and concept. I remember very distinctly, I was in California in the fall of 1976, in the months before Gay American History was published, and word was circulating about it even before publication. I remember going to Modern Times, a left-wing bookstore and collective in San Francisco to see if they had the book on order. And the guy, I can't remember who it was, but the guy from the collective who was working there that day told me they had almost four dozen advance orders for the book. And I was experiencing Jonathan's excitement from afar. It's like, oh my God, this is amazing. But also, you know, about the book, part of the greatness of the book for me is that it wasn't or isn't a traditional historical narrative. I mean, the fact is that really Jonathan had discovered enough documents, and not all of them get into the book, he had discovered enough documents that he could have constructed a broad interpretive narrative if he had wanted to. But when I think about it now, if he had done that, it might very well have closed doors rather than opened them. And instead, the decision to have a documentary narrative grouped according to themes and commonalities actually opened endless possibilities for anybody who read it. It made the work of research visible and concrete. It encouraged others to do what he had done. I know for a fact, for instance, that Alan Berryby found a whole new direction to his life after he read Gay American History. He began doing for San Francisco what Jonathan had done nationally, which is a deep searching for primary materials connected to queer life in San Francisco and its environments. Many of Jonathan's thematic sections, trouble, resistance, love, actually, when you think about it, became the organizing frameworks for two decades of historical writing, you know, that many of us maybe we didn't realize it, but we were fleshing out the way Jonathan had constructed his book. Also, again, personally, the vast array of compelling documents made gay American history this extraordinary resource for teaching. I can't imagine a better first book in the field for facilitating the work of teaching and curriculum. When there's virtually no work published on something, how the hell do you teach it? I mean, how do you include it in courses? Do you have to wait a generation for the literature to develop before you can do anything with it? Well, I started teaching in 1983 at UNC Greensboro. It wasn't a time or a place where you would have been teaching an LGBT history course. I was teaching a US history course, a lot of 20th century US history courses. I developed a broad undergraduate course on the history of sexuality in the US, and gay American history was an amazing resource for me. It allowed me to incorporate LGBT history not only into my sexuality course, but in other history courses as well. There's a whole set of undergraduates, former undergraduates in North Carolina, who had never met an openly gay person except for me, who were not only meeting me, but were absorbing material about this in a history course. I used a batch of material from gay American history, all of it fascinating and thought-provoking. I especially remember the one that just always pops out for me when I think about this, the document about Alan Hart, which in effect was really a short biography of a trans man, but it was masquerading as a medical journal article. But the richness of it is that it just opened up wonderful discussions in the classroom about gender and about where our ideas and experience of gender come from and how these develop and change. And that was just one example of the many things that gay American history made possible. I also want to, though, add that there's much more to Jonathan's legacy than gay American history and his historical research. There's also the context in which Jonathan always placed his work. The fact, for instance, that he chose the theater as the setting for first presenting his historical research. The audiences that history might reach in that way that might not have been reached through a book. The way that theater dramatized and made more emotionally immediate and more collective, the doing and sharing of history. There was the fact that Jonathan turned up at that meeting of what became the Gay Academic Union and put himself in dialogue with academics, even though he wasn't one. There was the fact that Jonathan always tied himself to activist settings and frameworks. After some of us, if you were here yesterday for a panel, you heard a little bit about this, but after the Gay Academic Union, for instance, Jonathan and I and a few other folks formed a group called the Gay Socialist Action Project. We not only read Marx and Engels, and really we read many, 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 many pages of Marx and Engels, but we also mobilized people. Jonathan drew on his research into the medical profession to write a manifesto that we used in a zap that was like my favorite demonstration of my life, in which we shut down a panel of truly homophobic psychiatrists in Manhattan. The Gay Socialist Action Project organized community forums in the city to discuss political actions. We organized a New York City gay contingent to the counter bicentennial demonstrations in Philadelphia in 1976. We helped organize a demonstration outside the Democratic Convention that was held in New York in the summer of 1976. Jonathan's scholarship was always an activist-oriented and committed scholarship that was aiming for audiences and for influence beyond the world of the academy, you know, from the beginning, and that is still true. And so Having said that, in closing, what I'd like to most emphasize about Jonathan and the legacy of gay American history is how, for me, it continues to model being grounded in a world outside the academy. And there's, in some ways, there's great irony in this, because gay American history facilitated the doing of research and scholarship within the academic world. It helped make possible an academic field of LGBT studies and LGBT history and queer studies. But the opening of the academy to this sort of research also dramatically increases the likelihood that more and more of us who do it will be swallowed into what can be described as the abyss of professionalism, that without even realizing it, we will increasingly speak primarily to each other and primarily engage with each other and abandon the role of service to a broader community and movement. And I think what I most appreciate about Jonathan's trajectory as a researcher, a writer, and a historian is that he's never lost a sense of himself as an agent of change, as a fighter for justice, in which history is a really vital tool for pushing those things forward. So thank you, Jonathan, for modeling that.
Already lived up to it.
You must continue.
I actually, John and I talked about this a little bit before, and he said, I'm just going to reminisce a little bit about how important the network of scholars that we had in the 80s and just what a big, wonderful thing it was. Well, I'm very glad that I made a decision, which, after thanking Jonathan and the organizers, to not try to do what John did, because he did it better than I could have done it. And so first I want to lead off by saying how much I appreciate this conference and the organizers of it and all the people, Kevin and Daniel, and
all the volunteers
and the, you know, lunch servers and all that, and what for me has been a very sweet reunion, really sweet, and a chance to meet and together and also hear what some of our intellectual descendants are doing, which is very exciting. And Jonathan's not only past contributions, but continuing contributions completely merit this celebration. And I'm very proud to say that Jonathan and I have been friends for a long time, and I always love seeing him. And then on the topic of gay American history specifically, gay American history, not only do I still use it in teaching, but it showed me how I could use my undergraduate training in history to advance the causes that we both believe in, namely lesbian and gay liberation, anti-racism, feminism, and a critical, I'll just say, a critical attitude toward capitalism that we share. So what I'm going to read is some excerpts from chapter 7 of this memoir that is finally coming to fruition. And this chapter is called I Loved Lesbian Feminist New York. And lesbian feminism, as others have pointed out, is Let me just, a side thing. I saw CNN did this series like the 60s, the 70s, the 80s. They didn't even mention lesbian feminism. I mean, not even like two words. And I thought, what? You know, hey, we invented Subarus and you know, political correctness. That comes from lesbian feminism. Oh, great. So, I mean, lesbian feminism wasn't just one moment, and it went some places in the end that I wasn't happy with, but in the beginning it was so wonderful, and so I wanted to talk about that. And Jonathan and I are the same age, right? What year were you born?
38.
Oh, he's older than I am. I was born in 1940, so I don't know what Jonathan was doing in the 70s. I'm sure great things, but this is some of what I was doing. I was born in 1940 on the eve of World War II, and by the time of my adolescence in the 1950s, it was a given in upper middle class families like mine that girls would go to college, although the usual rationale was that a BA made them better wives and mothers. By the 1960s, as I was finishing college, Cold War government funding, and people, when they, I talk about this today, younger people are like, what? There was money pouring out of the government to fund anthropological research where I was in graduate school. And actually, you didn't have to, in my case, I didn't even have to apply directly to the government because they would give these block grants, and then the mentors, the professors, could give out the block grants to whoever they wanted, which was great for my dissertation, because that would have never been funded by the government. So graduate schools were admitting far more women than they ever had before, but the pressure to marry was so great that advanced training produced more marriages than women professionals. Such women more often married male professionals than went on to such careers themselves, and the pressure was so intense. There were lots of women in my graduate school cohort, and they were pressured to marry the male graduate students and then go to become their field helpers, and they would go interview the women and stuff like that. Although I had had problematic sex with men in college, I could not bring myself to marry. And so, my family having no trust fund to bestow, I was going to have to support myself. Two brief stints at relatively menial jobs. I was a waitress one summer, and I was a library file clerk at another time, convinced me that career was a better option. But one could not be openly homosexual as a professional. Impossible, okay? You had no choice but to lead a deceptive public life and a separate and secret private one. And there was another problem. I was a gender deviant, as we said then, a masculine, Kevin on both sides here, a masculine woman that made hiding my sexual orientation even harder, since masculinity was supposed to be the mark of a lesbian. Throughout my academic career, my persona, interests, and feminist gay, later feminist gay politics blocked my advancement, so much so that in the 1970s, although I never quit my tenured professorship, which I fought really hard to get, I was almost completely alienated from the whole notion of having a career just when I could have been piling up accomplishments. Aside from outright discrimination, during the part of my life described in this memoir overall, my research and writing had no context and no audience. For example, when Mother Camp came out, it got no reviews. The only review it got was from Edward Sagarin. This is such a mind fuck. Edward Sagarin, who was a closeted sociologist and who had written, what was the name of the book he wrote? The Homosexual in America under a pseudonym. And he trashed my book. Oh, this is horrible. He hated the whole idea of identity politics. And I think that was the only review that ever happened. I mean, it just fell into a complete void. And I have to really thank the University of Chicago because they picked it up in 1979 and kept it in print till today. And so it ultimately found audiences. Let me see, where am I? As a professor, I was lucky to survive, much less thrive. By the 1980s, there started to be eager readers outside the universities and the beginnings of supportive institutional structures, especially women's studies programs and departments, and gay academic conferences, which were amazing. Mainstream publishers and academic presses started to take an interest in our work, and by our, I mean, you know, lots of people here. And this, more than academic support, and with the exception of one person who was sitting in this audience, I was the only out gay or lesbian professor at my college from 1974 through the early 90s. Kim Christensen, hats off to you. Gave me hope, and all my work since then has been written not just for academic colleagues, but also for the national LGBT community that was taking shape. So what follows after this is excerpts from the period 1969 through the early 70s. After thrilling to the Miss America protests, which I saw on television in 1968, I found a women's liberation group, which was Upper West Side Witch, after trying out some others that I didn't like so well. My biggest hesitation about feminism was the fear that straight feminists would reject me. With the exception of my psychiatrist in Palo Alto, this is when I was 15 and 16, 12 years previously, I still had never confessed, and this is how we thought about it, my homosexuality to any straight person other than my closest college friend, Shirley. Not one. If you think about what that means, that we were living in a straight world, it was their world, you know, and they didn't want us in it. The fact that I had, well, and so I hid it. That was the solution, best I could. Even though I have met gay people that I wouldn't trust to wipe my glasses, and more recently, delightful gay-friendly straight people, there are many situations where, as a result of my years in the closet and loyalty toward my fellow outcasts, I see the world as us and them. A dance floor, a movie theater, a beach, they are all either gay or straight to me. I thought a feminist group would be straight, and in the beginning, that seemed true. After several months of silence, when the weekly topic would touch on boyfriends, women's work is unpaid labor, how to get him to share it, I blurted out that I was bisexual. Though I had never thought of myself that way, it was the most I could dare. They volleyed back reassurance. Feminism is about all women and the like, which was a very welcome response. We saw ourselves as leading a revolution that would change the world. When the second wave began, abortion was illegal, women could not get credit cards or mortgages in their own names, and husbands could not be arrested for raping their wives. So there has been great progress, for which feminism does not get the credit it deserves. But there has been no revolution against the patriarchy, much less the military-industrial state. The rich are richer than ever, and capitalist ideologues and advertisers have partly succeeded in transforming feminism into a career path for affluent white women. Lean in, you know. It would not be too much to say that our intentions were the opposite. We wanted off that track, and even to demolish that track entirely. And lots of people who came from upper middle class families and became feminists actually dropped out of graduate school or quit their jobs, the more class appropriate jobs. But instead of a left-wing feminist revolt, we got Reagan and the Bushes. Still, feminism was revolutionary also for me personally. Since childhood, I had resented my second-class status, and feminism legitimized my anger. Up to that point, my whole life had tended toward becoming, like Gertrude Stein or Marguerite Yourcenar, an exceptional woman, a woman fitting into a male world with masculine values and ideals. The feminist paradigm interrupted all that. My exceptionalism, I saw, was situated within the same gender matrix that constrained all other women. Now, when I thought about, for example, how I'd been reprimanded for wearing pants too often in graduate school, which was supposed to show a lack of commitment to anthropology, yet I was also told not to flirt with men because that would show you were a tramp and not a serious academic, I saw that dilemma in a political context, which was so helpful. The Stonewall riots in June of 1969 did not have as big an impact on me at first as the Miss America protest that September, which I actually attended. I had just finished my first year as an assistant professor of anthropology at Queens College in the CUNY system. My salary was around $9,000 a year, which meant the end of student poverty. I wanted to keep my job, especially because I had written my dissertation on a gay topic. I could not be publicly associated with gay protest. It would have ripped off the mask of objectivity on which I had depended, actually. You know, you couldn't ask about people's personal lives, and that was great with me. And there was no question in my mind that if my Queens College colleagues found out I was gay, I would be fired. But the riots thrilled me, and I wasn't completely surprised. The gay community of the mid-60s had been bubbling with furious energy. Many people in gay liberation were looking for radical personal and political change. The circumscribed middle-class lesbian networks that I had eventually found also were exploding outward. So despite my overwhelming fear, I attended one of the first Gay Liberation Front meetings at Washington Square Church. The men took up a lot of space, and it wasn't long before the lesbians, already influenced by women's liberation, suggested meeting separately. I have notes provided by my friend Catherine Morgan, who was then Catherine McGarg, from meetings that took place at my apartment on September 21st and September 28th in 1969. Catherine described these meetings as encounter groups, and with a lot of emotional back and forth and suggestions for trust building and holding hands, which, as Catherine noted, made me extremely anxious. The encounter group was short-lived, primarily, as I recall, because Lois Hart, the de facto leader of the group, and her girlfriend, whose name I think was Suzanne?
Suzanne.
What was her last name?
Bevier.
Bevier, okay. Wanted to try open relationships, much to my shock, since I was looking for a life partner. And I, at that point, I had one, the painter Louise Fishman. My love for her was part of that ferment. We read the new lesbian feminist writing to each other in bed, Patience and Sarah, and Woman Identified Woman. We went to CR groups together and separately, sharing our excitement at each new revelation and our anger at male privileges. We both demonstrated on the steps of the Metropolitan Museum for the inclusion of more women artists, and we went to It's All Right to Be Woman Theater with hundreds of other women, laughing and clapping at each reenactment of female humiliations and triumphs. We were at the Second Congress to Unite Women on May 1st, 1970, when a small group of lesbians calling themselves the Lavender Menace interrupted the program to demand lesbian inclusion. Foreshadowing the marriage equality movement, Louise and I thought of ourselves as married, of course knowing that the rest of the world did not. When Louise drew up a certificate of holy matrimony, which I found in my papers, for us, the only witnesses were our cats and dogs. We never thought of the economic penalties we suffered because we couldn't legally marry. What would have been the point? Legal marriage was as remote as the rings of Saturn. We lived our love in our apartment and among our gay and lesbian friends. A second attempt at a gay women's group was shaping up, and that's what it was, that's the exact words we used, gay women's group, was shaping up, and I volunteered to organize the first get-together, inviting, among others, sister activist Martha Shelley, a lifelong friend, and two women I had just met, Barbara Tower and Marianne Dan, both of whom lived on City Island off the Bronx, and they're a whole other story. I attended a gay forum where, for the first time, I spoke publicly about being a lesbian. The second annual Gay Pride Week was held in June of 1971, culminating in a Pride March. I thought the danger of being photographed was too great, and I planned to attend the gay-in at the end of the march in Central Park. But I had just had breakfast with, quote, a bunch of dykes, and those are my words. I kept voluminous journals at this period in my life, who were all going to the march, including Louise, and at the last minute I had to go or I couldn't live with myself. I saw lots of gay people on the sidelines, too scared to join us, and I knew just how they felt. But I was embracing a radical vision of gay liberation. Quote, the revolution is less authentic by every oppressed person it excludes, I wrote breathlessly in my journal, struggling with my repulsion toward a man swaddled in sheets who carried a sign announcing his membership in the Pennsylvania Enema Society. By July 15th, I was in love with the gay women's group and the 10 women in it. Nothing like this had ever happened in our lifetimes or ever in history. Lesbians meeting to share experience and anger, blown forward by the hurricane of feminist ideology, seeing ourselves on the crest of momentous change. The gay women's group idea caught on with others clamoring to join. As the groups had to stay small to be intimate, successive groups formed until there were at least 10. And I do believe these groups were a very important foundation to the lesbian feminist movement. On March 4th, 1972, we had dinner with Barbara Love and Sidney Abbott, who had just finished writing Sappho Was a Right-On Woman, one of the first lesbian feminist books to be published by a mainstream press, which was amazing. Despite their obviously privileged background, they lived on Lower Fifth Avenue, both were white and upper middle class. Barbara had lost her job when she had come out at work and been featured as a, quote, admitted lesbian on TV and in Life magazine. Barbara's family virtually, or perhaps even actually, disowned her. While we were there, a former lover called, furious that Barbara might have blown her cover by coming out. Sydney didn't have a job either, and they were getting desperate. That kind of story convinced me to stay silent. I was coming up for tenure again the next year, after being fired the first time. The brightest star in the lesbian feminist firmament was the former downtown dancer and Village Voice columnist Jill Johnston. Louise and I had devoured Marmalade Me, and Jill was just coming out with a new book, Lesbian Nation. Despite her bohemian charisma, she often wore a black bowler hat, leather pants with metal studs. Jill had been married mother 15 years before. I had met Jill at a party, so that when I heard her speak about this new lesbian nation at the School of Visual Arts, she recognized me in the audience, much to my thrill. And I wrote, "She is tall, awkward, though a dancer, charming, gentle, yet oddly cruel, as I imagine extremists are." She was an extremist, in all the best and worst ways. Hers is not a cruelty of intent, but a cruelty of detachment, of single-mindedness, of the artist mystic. Unlike Anais Nin, she will not fail as an artist through being too human. And that was something that Anais Nin wrote about herself. To a woman in the audience who babbled on nervously about human liberation and men's problems, Jill replied, "It's okay if you want to stop part way, but as for me, I'm going all the way with this thing." Questions of leadership and stardom were painful in second wave feminism. We young women were mostly from comfortable families, yet brothers had been favored and boys had sucked the air out of every room. In opposition to patriarchy and in line with all men are created equal, we were committed to the proposition that all sisters were equally important, that decisions must be made collectively, and that everyone must be included. Yet the media wanted spokeswomen, and Jill was colorful and articulate. This made some women envious and resentful, while others were mixed up and conflicted. And I'll end with an anecdote about this, which I think foreshadows the magnetic allure of mainstream acceptance that is now ascendant in our world. Martha Shelley came over one day in tears because her prominence within lesbian feminism left her confused about who she was. She'd been elated beyond reason when Ms. Magazine, the more mainstream feminist publication, asked her to do an article. But then she felt bad because maybe she was lording it over other women. So she wrote a half-baked article that, in part, was critical of Ms. They got pissed off and stopped taking her phone calls. Her feelings were hurt, and she had to face how much she actually wanted to publish in Ms. Magazine. Thank you.
I met Jonathan in 1978, along with John D'Amelio, over a pickle and a donut. Lest you think we were introduced and had a quick snack at some fusion Lower East Side Jewish deli. They didn't exist then. I will explain the pickle and the donut in a circuitous way. First, to locate this 1978 conference was, as far as I knew, the very first conference on sexuality organized. I was still a graduate student. This was the first paper I had ever given, and I was terrified. I was still writing it the night before. I would have to say it was fueled by anger, which I'll explain, and the comments yesterday of Susan Stryker and Sarah Schulman made me reflect on how much of my work initially was driven by anger. And as I thought further about this, perhaps you will think this is a specious distinction, but I thought rage, you know, leads to murder, but anger, if it's put together with curiosity, can go somewhere productive and useful. My circuitous journey also involved graduate study in anthropology. As a graduate student, I was not permitted to pick sex roles as one of my areas of concentration for my exam in the department of Margaret Mead. I was later almost kicked out since some senior men said I was much more interested in women than anthropology.
Oh, yeah. That's how it was, sister.
But to be fair, I also have to add that I was saved from being kicked out by some of my advisors who were men. I became interested in sexuality, fueled by personal discussions, political discussions, and it dawned on me, anthropology, ding, ding, ding. I could use the tools I've been trained to study this. Doesn't anthropology have a great reputation for being in the vanguard of exciting studies about sexuality all over the world? The career advice was a little discouraging. It will ruin your career, but in any case, wait until you have tenure to do anything about this. I was pondering this advice when I first began teaching at CUNY at Lehman College. There, I put in a small junior faculty proposal to do an utterly tame annotated bibliography of anthropological work on sexuality. It was refused, and the critical sheets said, one, I was too young, and second, I didn't read Japanese. And thus, I would be unable to read the very earth-shakingly important new research about a particular type of Japanese monkey that was then thought to have the key to human sexual behavior. I still remember reading these sheets and being incredulous doesn't even begin to describe it. Now, a normal person would have evaluated all that information, ending with these sheets, and sensibly decided to pursue another topic. I guess we conclude I was not a sensible person because on seeing the fire, I thought, I'm going to run right into it because it's even crazier than I thought. So, being somewhat discouraged about my chosen discipline, I thought, all right, I will go to a renowned sexuality institute because they are much more open and have much more information. That is where I met the pickle and the donut in the form of an animated cartoon that all the participants viewed in a large group sitting on pillows on the floor, along with many other cartoons. Now, the pickle and the donut was presented as a wry commentary on heterosexuality and male-female relations. I will be more concrete. The donut represented the female. The pickle represented the male. And a very torturous road, knocked over furniture, running around bushes, trampling over animals, the pickle pursued the donut, despite her very vigorous efforts to evade. This was what passed for humor and education in sexology at that time. After a week of this, I, of course, was furious. And the paper I gave with the pickle and the donut commented on the underlying assumptions in this entire institute. It was a very rollicking paper, for which I can take no credit, since, you know, anthropology is like stenography. You just write down what people say. And if your topic is sexuality, what you write down will be very astounding. So I gave this paper, and you may have a different memory, but I remember Jonathan and John D'Amelio approaching me after the paper and introducing themselves and inviting me to join a study group that was then ongoing. I got the feeling that if I could see, you know, the cartoon bubble coming out of your head, it might say, we have no idea who you are. You don't seem like us. Did you fly in from another planet like Mars? But we sort of like how you think. And I felt the same way about them.
Hear that?
So I joined the study group. And this leads me to make a couple of comments in the way John did, and about situated knowledge and the conditions for knowledge production. At that time, the respectable areas to do work and write about sexuality, certainly medicine in regard to venereal disease, reproduction, psychiatric pathologies, and marriage and family studies, where the goal was on studying marital dysfunction and other kinds of sexual conflicts that could cause family disharmony and divorce. There were no journals of the kind you know now and publish in. There were no jobs. There were no job ads looking to hire anybody in sexuality or queer theory. So even for the people who then went to these study groups, some were in academic training, some were not, it was very much like growing African violets or playing tennis. It was a hobby that you did, certainly I did, in addition to my real job. No one would, you wouldn't even put it on your CV because that would be ridiculous. And where could you publish anyway, but in very important publications like Gay Community News and The Body Politic, which both have a very distinguished history of publishing the most original, new, and important work that was then being generated about sexuality. So, like John, I have some questions, or perhaps I'll throw it to you, you know, which Gail Rubin has asked as well in one of her papers. Surely the institutionalization, the professionalization of gay and lesbian studies and different kinds of sexuality studies is something we all worked for and greeted with pleasure. But it happens sometimes when I give a talk somewhere, after the talk, graduate students want my opinion. They ask my advice. And they say, oh, could you please share with us about how you planned your career? And I, you know, try to not laugh, and I try to bite my tongue, and I try not to say, when you see a fire that interests you, just run into it. Which is to say that the considerations of prudence, calculation, all sorts of things that are normal in careers of professional advancement, I actually don't know much about. And I think in a way it's a gain, it's a big gain, because you can't really expect a big body of knowledge to be produced by people who are, you know, are growing African violets on the side after they work a normal job, right? But I think it's worth thinking what's been lost as well in this development. Jim Downs yesterday, I think, described one study group in his paper. This was a different study group, and I think it was a very important one because there were women in it, there were straight people in it, and I think we were curious about each other, but it wasn't a personal group, it was an intellectual group, and the issues we were interested in seemed to have such resonance, if not parallelism, that the conversations were incredibly provocative. We, of course, duly read our readings, and we came and talked about them, and, you know, got in these millions of cartons I have stuck in the attic. I wonder what kind of record there is of the different readings and the notes, because I think that alone would be very fascinating. For myself, many political movements, certainly feminism, gay and lesbian liberation, raised many questions that led to my work, but it always seemed to me it was a terrible mistake to let those movements in your head limit your answers. I mean, if that were the case, don't bother to do research because you know what the answer is before you start. You know, save yourself a lot of aggravating time in the library or doing field work. This study group format, I have wondered, is it American? Did it happen in Europe? Did it happen in the UK? Did it happen in India? Did it happen in Australia? Or is it some sort of intellectual variant of the potluck that has proliferated here? If so, yay to it. Personally, I found these study groups and the intellectual excitement they supported and generated to be totally sustaining of most of the work I had done. Many questions were raised in these groups. Some are now would be familiar to any student who had finished the first kind of course in sexuality studies or gay and lesbian history. How do we make room for the body, dissonant bodies, bodies as sites of knowledge and experience, sites of suffering and pleasure, while at the same time denaturalizing the body as the source of truth claims, as the source of claims to power and domination? How do we critically examine received knowledge, be it religious, scientific, medical, or any other? How do we get traction on how sexuality is socially organized in whatever place we study? How can we disconnect behavior and meaning, finally understanding that sexual acts, behavior, do not carry meanings with them everywhere like a suitcase, that the meetings, the behavior can be very split and move around in very different ways? How do we explore how sexuality is used by the state in a range of projects, political projects, some appearing not to have much directly to do with sexuality? And how do we really explore the way that all important social distinctions in the place and time we study, whatever they might be, race, caste, sex, whatever it may be, intersects with sexuality? So for example, sexuality is raced and race is sexualized. And that's essential to how systems of stratification and inequality operate. Finally, I think, and some of these questions, in my understanding, were raised in Susan's talk, how do the projects of sexual dissidents and gender dissidents speak to each other? How are they entwined? How are they separate? What intellectual tools do we need to see each one through? In her presentation of clips, Sylvia Rivera, Gino Leary, who memorably to me said, men want us to be their entertainment. And her recounting of Robin Morgan and others' wish to throw Beth Elliott out of performing. These exclusions fell very heavily on trans people. In my mind, they felt very heavily on feminists too. You may disagree, and I'd be the first to admit that lesbian feminism made many contributions, but and it would be unfair to locate what I'm about to describe as the solely connected to lesbian feminism. That would be very wrong. But these questions, should trans women be excluded? What do we make of gay male drag? These are questions circling around what's the relationship of feminism to men and masculinity? What's the relationship of those things to patriarchy? Is a deep suspicion of men and masculinity? How far does that go? What's the difference between interrogation and then final kind of a naturalization? Is the solution of equality through sameness? Is sexuality the site of women's oppression? And is then penetration the ultimate foundational metaphor for patriarchy? Could masculinity be detached from biological men? And would that be a good or a bad thing? Is imitation, can it be put in the service of subversion or appreciation? What about imitation with a twist? That's not absolutely imitation. And finally, what do we make of gender appropriation? What do we think of irony or humor? Most famously, do we have any? Finally, and I think the point of Jonathan's work, a project that spanned many activists, many scholars, many countries, is finally how sexuality had a history or histories, and our efforts to grapple with that. Along with the other panelists, I would like to thank Jonathan for his long devoted inquiry. They were incredibly sustained. They were carried on often without a great supportive resource. Anyone who has ever borrowed an article that he's read or a clipping from the New York Times will see Talmudic annotation on every sentence. Talmudic, or we could call it Jesuitical in the spirit of, you know, openness. And reading through the annotations is an education in itself, because it spoke to, it embodied the effort to deconstruct and denaturalize. So I would like to thank him for his many theoretical contributions, as well as his empirical contributions, his perseverance and his constant curiosity, which indeed led later to work on, goodness me, heterosexuality. His courage in confronting some of the political implications of the history of sexuality, or most famously, in a conference, people getting very angry to hear that homosexuality, as we understand it, did not exist throughout all time, and it's a real blow about Leonardo, but let alone the Greeks, a bummer. Someone we all know said, got up and said, we'll deconstruct, meaning gays and lesbians, after they do, meaning the heterosexuals. So amid these many conversations that have spent many years, and I hope continue for many years to come, I'd like to thank Jonathan for his work, his curiosity, his dedication, and his generosity.
To take all this in, it's wonderful. It's wonderful, and I'm so glad all of you are here to think and to celebrate. Here's the mode of production of this conference. Daniel Marshall gave birth to the idea. He carried the baby to Claire Bond Potter at the New School Digital Humanities Initiative, and she blessed it. Kevin Jennings, head of the Arcus Foundation, funded it. Nan Boy, John D'Amelio, Stephen Seidman, and Randall Sells advised. Kevin Nadel, director of the Center for LGBT Studies at CUNY, lent the support of CLAGS. Kevin Ewing was hired to organize the event, and he and many others unknown to me have made it happen. And contrary to the structuralist, functionalists, the human agents are agenting, the subjects are alive and kicking, the authors are not dead, the constructors are constructing, the producers are producing. This is supposed to take about 10.5 minutes. I looked it up, and you can do that number of words on the internet. This has all been so exciting and such an honor, and it's going to take a while for me to take it all in and digest it and appreciate it fully as I need to. I just want to say thanks. It's lovely. It's really lovely. So here's the talk. Envisioning the world we make continued. 40 years after gay American history, I still love digging up the empirical evidence that reveals us humans in all our historically specific glory or debauchery. For example, thanks to a successful Freedom of Information Act request, Out History recently published 92 pages from the Journal of the President of Mississippi Southern College, 1955-65. These documents, in blatant homophobic detail, detail the purging of homosexuals from the campus of what is now the University of Southern Mississippi in Hattiesburg. And by the way, that president of that university is famous for his trying to keep blacks out of this university and other universities in Mississippi, but nobody has yet tied up his homophobia with his racism. And it's a shocking, been shocking to me, I'm adding now to my 10 minutes. It's been shocking to me that the campus newspaper did not report anything about these 92 pages. No newspaper in Mississippi has picked up on this amazing, dramatic information that's in these documents. Anyway, it's shocking. But along with such empirical manual labor as getting those documents, I'm also deeply interested in the theorizing that helps us understand the human making of the human world, past and present. In the essay I published on Out History in February, Envisioning the World We Make, you can read it there, I began to present my understanding of what I called the social historical mode of construction. To comprehend humans' shaping of this world, I suggested we need to study the particular historical character and organization of certain basic elements of the construction process. I proposed that every human construction process includes a minimum of 10 basic elements: actors, their aims, materials, means of action, acts, time, space, objects and effects constructed, the relationships among all of these elements, that makes for a lot of relationships, and their mode of organization. These abstractly conceived elements and modes, I stressed, exist and can only be studied in their empirically specific social historical forms. I presented this abstract general model as a tool for analyzing the empirical data that illuminates historically specific arrangements of human activity. The value of the proposed theoretical model, I suggested, will only become clear when this conceptual tool is applied creatively to reveal the variable, infinite complexity of the empirically documented social world. To suggest how this abstract model might work as an analytical tool, I applied it to heterosexuality, the love whose history dares not speak its name. Still, that's true, still pretty true. So I applied it to heterosexuality. But in the course of further study over the following months since February, I've become concerned. I worry about presenting mode of production theory specifically as a tool for analyzing sexual history. This may seem to limit the general application of mode of production theory. So today I stress a combination of social construction theory and Marxist mode of production theory is a conceptual tool for analyzing the social historical ordering of all kinds of human activity. Since publishing the Envisioning essay, I have continued to study the close relationship between social construction theory, Marxist mode of production theory, and other social historical paradigms. I have looked at the various conceptual models applied to the social study of sexuality, social construction theory, scripting theory, network theory, choice theory, field theory, probably some others. I have investigated what models are informing the study of a newly named critical heterosexual history. The woman who's editing the journal was here earlier. Maybe she's still here. There's a book coming out on critical heterosexual history. I've begun to survey what's said about the social historical construction of gender with particular attention to the work of feminist, left, transgender authors and what's been said about the subjective making of that queer thing, non-transgender. That is the thing, the way, the appropriate thing, the normal gender, which that needs to be looked into. It really does, like heterosexuality. That's it's weird. I've begun to research the history of ideas about this social construction of race as well, and its intersection with other major social divisions. I've considered what radical and Marxist feminists have said about the social historical construction of women's work in the capitalist domestic sphere. I've read what feminists have said about the role of women in the organization of human reproduction, the mode of producing new humans. There's a mode of production of new humans. I've looked again at sociologist Talcott Parsons' formulation of his self-styled voluntary theory of human action, and I've continued to marvel at how this once very prominent thinker, he's a thinker, sort of, managed to completely ignore Marx's mode of production theory that focuses centrally on the historically changing distribution among humans of the means of effective action. I've looked at discussions of mode of production theory in works tracing the transition from one mode of production to another, from feudalism to capitalism, for instance. I've studied works that develop mode of production theory in reference to colonialism and imperialism, economic development, and underdevelopment. I've studied Marx's analysis of the production of use values in contrast to the production of exchange values. I've looked at works that contrast capitalism's production of objects for profit with a socialism's production of objects for use. The purpose of these studies was to better understand the relation of Marxist mode of production theory and social construction theory. I've now concluded that these theories are, as I understand them, identical. When Marx focused his analysis on the history and character of capitalism, he came up with a major insight about society in general. He saw human societies as different ways humans organized the construction of the human world. Societies, he saw, are different human ways of making things. But because Marx focused on capitalism, he failed to fully develop his general insight into human societies as ways of organizing all kinds of production. That's because under capitalism, only waged acts which produce profit are considered productive. Given that criteria, women's unwaged work in the domestic sphere is not productive. The procreation and education of new humans is not productive unless it's made profitable somehow. Marx's years of work analyzing the capitalist economy are not productive. Under capitalism, a major qualitative distinction is made between profit-producing activities organized as the economy and other fields of activities distinguished as ideological, political, legal, scientific, cultural, educational, familial, etc. The capitalist economy is conceived as distinct from the system of idea construction, the production of scientific knowledge, the creation of culture, the domestic, familial, and educational system productive of new humans. The political, legal, policing, and military institutions that produce coercion. I suggest that all kinds of human activity are organized as historically specific, coexisting, interrelated modes of production. I suggest that we extend Marxist mode of production theory beyond what is usually thought of as economic acts and the economy. I suggest that we need to study the arrangement under which human activity constructs all kinds of things and effects. We need, for example, to analyze the mode of production of ideas within today's US colleges and universities. We need to analyze the production within academia of ideas about the production of ideas in academia. We need to analyze the hierarchical division of manual and mental labor within academia that radically separates theorizing about modes of production from empirical research on modes of production. We need to critique from the left the obscure high academic language used by many theorists to assert their brilliance and establish their own social capital within the hierarchies of academe.
Yay.
I haven't heard anybody use any of that jargon in here in this conference. It's really interesting. We need new creative ways of talking to people about relations between theory and practice and the strategies for radical progressive change. In discussing the extension of Marxist mode of production theory to all human acts, I hope to stimulate public debate on the usefulness of these ideas about society and history. I suggest that some of us might want to form critical history study groups. We need to, these study groups, look what they gave birth to discuss the relation between social construction theory and Marxist mode of production theory and their application to sexuality, sex, gender, class, race, power, human action, and the creation of a more just social world. When an openly admitted democratic socialist can run for president of the United States, garnering huge numbers of enthusiastic supporters, it's time to take a second look at Marxism as a theory of the human making and remaking of the human world. I look forward to your responses here and emailed to outhistory@gmail.com. And you'll be able to read this talk. I'll add it to Out History very soon. Thank you.
So we have about 30 minutes left, and what I would like to do is to engage the audience in some questions, and we'll have a moderator go around. I do just have a few comments that I just wanted to share. I think one thing that I've taken away from this conference, and especially this panel, is just the importance of talking about history and the importance of making sure that future generations are aware of this history. I think about where we are now, and I, as someone who's in an in-between generation, Generation Y, I've benefited so much from all of your work and all of your work here in the audience as well, where it may have been somewhat difficult to study queer studies and to do work related to LGBTQ communities, but to hear your stories of just how hard it was and how trailblazing you had to be and how much you had to run into the fire and the risk that you had to take is just really remarkable. And then I think about future generations that and current generations of younger people who don't know this history at all. And I wonder if, despite the fact that we have more visibility in mainstream media and whatnot, if you have any thoughts on how we can make sure that people not just know the basic information about LGBTQ folks, but really understand the history of LGBTQ people here in the United States and globally, if you have any thoughts about that.
Go for it.
I'd rather hear.
Yeah,
other
I think
people
they
talk.
Should.
It's okay. Fine, but and those things will come up as we hear more.
Sure, absolutely. So that was just a thought, and so we have an opportunity for people to share questions or to ask questions and to share thoughts and perspectives.
I'll say it again because no one heard it.
Yeah.
I'd like you to comment on the queering of intellectual friendship and how that has bound you together.
Well, if I understand what you mean, I would say this reached an apogee in the 80s. Where the bonds that you see evident were formed. And you're, what you said, certainly, what year did you say you met them?
78,
so even earlier than I did. I met a lot of these people through Amber Hollibaugh. She introduced me to John D'Amelio, Jeff Escoffier, who's here. And we were really tight. And it makes me think of, and obviously, for the most part, it wasn't sexual. It was a common curiosity, common ideological framework, love of research, LGBT liberation. It wasn't T at that time. But it wasn't B either in the beginning, but it was LG or GL or whatever. Actually, it was just gay, like I said. and it was just so important. I just can't emphasize that enough. So sustaining, both intellectually and personally. I don't think I could have survived. I mean, I did gay work, which was kind of foundational in anthropology, with no support, and then my work just fell off a cliff, you know? Well, support, yes, for my mentor. That's the only reason I got a degree, aside from my own work. But what happened in the 80s allowed me to put together my life experience and interests with my academic work and my thought processes and my teaching. I mean, I mentioned before, maybe not enough, but I began to use pieces, especially the ones on passing women, from Jonathan's book, And students were just, wow, you know, they were just blown away by it. So, and then knowing him, and it reminds me of a piece that was hugely influential for me by an anthropologist named Edward Sapir. And he wrote a piece that I have read and reread called Culture, Genuine and Spurious. And it was very, very critical of the then capitalist America. That's what he was calling the spurious or false culture. And he contrasted that with eras that had been hugely productive artistically and intellectually, like, you know, Shakespeare's London or Venice at a certain point or Florence, and tried to analyze the parts of it that, what made it so productive. And one of the things that he talked about the most was face-to-face interaction between the various culture producers, sometimes not very friendly, but with us it was pretty darn friendly. And it just was an amazing, we talked about that, you know, it was just allowed us to make many more steps in our intellectual research teaching journeys than we had been able, I mean, because I read Jonathan's book is because I started teaching gay history to undergraduates, which was like, you know, a wonderful thing. So that would be my answer. It's just, so you can't overestimate the importance of that.
Can I say just a couple of brief things about it? One is it, what your question just reminded me of, how much of this in the 70s and into the 80s occurred in community spaces.
Yes.
That were therefore open to anybody who wanted to come to them. You know, like I think in San Francisco of the events at the Women's Building, for instance, and their accessibility, or times here where we met at the Church of the Beloved Disciple on 14th
yes.
Street, or the School for Marxist Education on Sheridan Square and stuff like that. And the intensity and energy was really amazing. Now, I actually still experience that kind of intensity when, and I don't know if Amanda is still here, when I go to the American, if I'll admit, the American Historical Association annual meetings, and the Committee on LGBTQ History has its events,
right.
And
yeah.
it's incredible. Oh, there you are. Yeah, it's incredibly wonderful. And I want to say, though, the difference between that space and those other spaces is that I think there are a lot of people who would feel excluded from that space. So those of us who are in that space really feel this intense connection, that queer solidarity, but we've also created boundaries that we don't notice when we're experiencing that queer solidarity because it's at a professional association. So.
I lived alongside this production for a long, long time. And there's a couple of things that come to mind. And
maybe you should explain.
I was Jonathan's partner for almost 3 decades. And I met him right around the time that Gay American History came out. And I don't know that it's come up in this conference, but there were thousands and thousands and thousands of 3x5 cards. and I lived among them, I tripped over them, I probably threw them around the apartment, and a lot of piles of newspaper with all those markings. But I think the fact of those cards, it's just useful for the young people to remember this was all done before computers. And those cards, I think, really spoke to Jonathan's process and his mind, that he was finding these little pieces of facts and he was putting them together, and he was organizing them, and he was moving them around. And so I think those cards are part of the process, but they're very much an emblem of Jonathan's process. The way his mind works. The other thing, and actually Ed and I were members of the Body Politic Collective, and we were reminiscing last night, but John alluded to the protest that occurred at the New York Academy of Medicine, where you guys broke up a meeting of psychiatrists. And that was around the time I met Jonathan. I heard about it over and over and over again. And there was an exuberance to that moment because, I mean, you know, Esther has talked about the challenges and the fact that, you know, and Carol too, about being sort of, it being dangerous territory. But it was also such exciting territory, and I could feel that, you know, we stood up and we interrupted and they had to walk over us in their fur coats and their high heels because they kind of laid down in the auditorium. And Ed and I, you know, we had protests on the streets of Toronto kissing when they were arresting men for kissing. So I think what I'm sort of saying here is how much hard work it was to gather those cards and put them together and make a point of them. But there was a lot of fun amidst the struggle, and it's useful to remember that fun because it, you know, we were changing the world.
It was fun. I'll say something about the camaraderie of the study groups. They were critical. That we were critical of things we read, but I don't remember it as no one was politically correct. There was no sort of starting dogma we weren't afraid of being stupid. We also developed these long time friendships as well as these intellectual exchanges that enriched us and the idea that it's more and more complex. The more you know, the more complex it gets. It doesn't get simpler. No. It gets more complex. So I think that was an insight I take from those study groups. And I just also in the study groups and the kinds of relationships that were created in this period, the early period, and then a little bit later when Alan Berrabay was living in the house that with David and myself. I want to invoke Alan Berrabay's aura in this setting here, that he is with us still, even though he died very young suddenly. It was just such a lovely, lovely thing to know this wonderful angelic person, Alan, and I really wanted to mention his name, that we honor his name here too. He was such a sweetie pie, and smart, and bringing the history to the people. History for the people!
My name is Jeff Escoffier. I just wanted to add a little to comments that have come up, and a very important dimension was the establishment of community history projects all around the country that have led, in some cases, to amazing institutions, such as the San Francisco Lesbian and Gay History Project, or History Museum, which has also added letters. So. But that was a very, very important dimension before it really began. Yes, right. Susan was the director. So that's a whole dimension that's apart from the professionalization and the academic piece of it, is that there were these community projects all around the country. They're in Boston, Philadelphia, Providence, and so on.
That's too bad.
Hi, I'm Amanda Latower. I wanted to thank John for the quick shout out to the CLGBT history. So we're the Committee on LGBT History. The organization's been around since the late 70s, thanks in part to many of you. And I am co-chair currently with Nick Surratt, and a couple of our board members are here. Rebecca and Tim was here, our previous board member, and Aaron Lechleiter and Stephen Veter, and we're really, we would love, it's an organization that is open to all historians and those who are interested in LGBT history. So not just for professional historians. You can join for as little as $10 if you really want to join and don't have $10, just send us an email. We will add you anyway. So it's clgbthistory.org. And we would love to broaden our community to include ever more of you. So thank you.
There's one.
Yeah, Gary Kinsman. So thanks so much for the panel. I wanted to just mention around Jonathan's work. I remember you coming to Toronto and speaking at the Gay Alliance Towards Equality. And I have to say that some of those early discussions are what really got me inspired in terms of doing queer history in the context of Canada. But I mostly wanted to talk about the substance of your talk today, because I really would want to urge everyone to read Jonathan's paper and to think about the reasons why we actually need to reconnect with earlier radical, sometimes Marxist, roots of where a lot of this historical work comes from. It's been denied, it's been forgotten, it's been actively excluded, and it's really important to rediscover that. And around study groups, I think study groups were not just formed in New York City, they've been formed everywhere. People form them when they need to figure out things, right? They're part of the construction work that people have to do in building movements. But I did want to say there's two different contexts in which study groups sometimes get produced. Sometimes it's actually in the context of a retreat from the struggle and activism, like we come up with too many roadblocks and we need to retreat for a while into a more, a different way of doing things where we read and we discuss. And I think the types of study groups we really need now are study groups that are not like that, that are actually study groups that are quite linked to activism and building movements and trying to sort things out in a very grounded activist way. So I do hope that we actually see this return to the radical roots of our movements and our historical work. And I think what Jonathan's suggesting is, like Frantz Fanon said, you needed to stretch Marxism to actually deal with racism, colonialism, imperialism. And I think what we need to do is not only to stretch and extend, but to queer Marxism, but also to be queer Marxists. Thanks.
Say your name. My name's Amber Hollibaugh. I have a question, but I also before that wanted to say something to all of you that really struck me when I was hearing the stories of the risks that you took and the price that each of you have paid. That I don't think that can be overemphasized, that you were willing to take those chances when there was no assumption of safety. And that the kind of, I mean, I know each of you, and I know the cost of trying to figure out a livelihood and how to move ideas forward when it could make you vulnerable. And I think that can't be overstated, Jonathan, in your work. You were not a traditional academic. You were not getting paid in a tenured position to do that work, and you weren't going to get rewarded in that way for it. And each of you have singular histories that are about the way that taking those chances were very important, but also very painful. I mean, I think of what happened to Carol around the conference, the sexuality conference at Barnard, and what Esther is talking about with your own life and what jobs you got and what jobs you didn't get and what recognition you got and didn't get. And you, John, sitting on the floor crying, going through your notes about what you wanted to do with your thesis because they told you that you'd never get a job if that's what you wrote. I mean, those are the things that I think often aren't talked about, of the cost of doing the work that now is so respected. And so I want to frame Gay American History's 40 years in the context of the risks that the work that grew from those times cost people as well as produced, because I don't think it was simply easy. And especially, Jonathan, I want to say to you, because I saw you a lot of times trying to figure out how to support yourself and do the work. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't an easy answer to that. So I want to thank all of you for that and for giving your hearts to not just your intellect, but your hearts and your passion to the creation of a world of ideas that we're now sitting here being a part of. Thank you.
My name is Bert Hansen. I just want to add a comment about the impact of this book and take us back to that time. John gave us a number of good points about the impact. But taking off from something that Esther said about we lived in a world of us and them. And we were beleaguered, we were oppressed, and we identified with each other. And at that point, we identified with lesbians and gay men alike. And what was different about this book, or what was real strength of it, was had he written the narrative history, or the interpretive history, it would have been one book by one author saying gays have a past, and it would have been dismissible. But by giving us the thick book that had nothing but documents in it from several centuries and from different social classes and different kinds of sources, it was undeniable to the them. It was inspiring to the us, and it helped a lot of people with their coming out and with other kind of things and with their relationships with their parents and all those other times. But the factual nature of it, which has always been Jonathan's strength, gave it a power beyond our community and in the wider world for opening things up and helping people understand it. And no one could deny gays had a past, even if in our own circles we argue about the interpretations here or there. It was that powerful, and it was that right on.
I would just say that, yeah, I think it was important that it was a documentary. I would say that there's implicit theory behind it, that if I hadn't earlier read Marx and Max Weber and Talcott Parsons even, I wouldn't have put together the same kind of a book. So I think that would be something to analyze, actually. It's sort of like maybe you'd call it vernacular theory or implicit theory. It'd be interesting to sort of bring out what that was. Some of the stuff I had learned in doing Black American history and the response that I got to that from a Black friend who said, why do we need to know more about that? When I it was a play I did about a very oppressive thing where a slave was taken back to freedom. And then I realized, oh, I have to do resistance history. I have to show the oppression. I have to do resistance history. That maybe is more nourishing for oppressed people to know about that. You can, even in horrible, usually, and even in really bad conditions, you can find ways of resisting. You can try to, anyway. So like that's a bit of the kind of theorizing and that went into it behind the documents.
Hi, I'm Don McLeod from Toronto. We've seen glimpses of the homophile movement here today, with the One and Mattachine Review and all of those things. And the people who were involved with that took great risks also. So I was wondering how they connect to the work that you were doing in the 1970s. Were they able to offer you advice? Did you meet them in person, like Franklin Kameny, or how do they fit into helping to form a movement in the 1970s?
Well, I'll quickly answer. The earlier work that had been done in bibliographies was just totally, really important. Yes. It was major. The Lesbian in Literature book and Barbara Greer's anthologies that were appeared first in the latter, I think, some of them, yeah. And then as pamphlets, and that was early historical research. Really, it was a form of early research, so it was really important. And the few articles that appeared in one quarterly, that's not as well known as one. There were really some good scholarly articles in there. One was about Walt Whitman, and it really impressed me. It was really good.
This is a little bit of a, what I'm going to say is a little bit of a different take on your question, but what I noticed in the 70s in interviewing people for sexual politics and sexual communities, that the people that I interviewed, in one way they were virtually all alike, but in another way they were quite different from each other. They were virtually all alike in that almost everyone said at some point in the interview something equivalent to, so, and I'm doing these interviews between 1976 and 1979 or 80. Never in my wildest dreams did I imagine that so much was going to change, meaning where we were now in the second half of the 70s, they never imagined that. But the way in which there was a real difference is that there were a bunch of people I interviewed who were not able in their lives and in their outlook to make the transition into the 70s and the forms that activism took and the sort of the way activism in our lives was analyzed and talked about. And there were others who made the transition really, really smoothly. And that was interesting to me. So.
Hi, I'm Ann Bailey. I wondered if any of you had thoughts about the way that the academic precarious workforce is going to affect the kind of camaraderie that was possible in the 70s, 80s, and 90s and is now increasingly less possible because so much academic jobs are part-time or temporary and queer people occupy a high percent of those. And that makes it harder for to take risks, to eat, all those things. And how does that affect the possibility of forming the kind of friendships and community that nurtured you and has nurtured me?
Well, actually, a lot of the people who were part of that network did not have academic jobs or were quite marginal. The job that I had was not what would have been expected from University of Chicago PhD student. Jonathan had problems supporting himself. Alan had no professional, background. Well, what did he have? He had a BA.
He was a dropout.
So actually, it was quite a mixed group then, or network, it would be better to say. But now I don't know how easily someone with no academic connections could participate in this dialogue. And that's been, John referred to that, and, that the institutionalization has been wonderful and also creepy. So I think what you're saying is very, very pertinent. I mean, when I came out of graduate school with my PhD in hand, there was no question that even with my weird dissertation, I still was going to get an okay job because there were jobs in academia in 1968 when I came out of got my degree. And now I see these brilliant students who, are forced to take postdocs if they can get them. So, I mean, definitely this whole thing is our history as gay intellectuals or queer intellectuals or whatever you want to say is definitely tied to the economy as a whole, and I don't know what shape that's going to take. Does anyone else?
Hi, I'm Randy. So just to add to that, I think, Amber mentioned how it's appreciated now. I mean, what I see is I don't know how appreciated it is now. And I look at young scholars struggling. I have a friend who has a doctorate from Harvard. I will try not to identify her too much. But, you know, last year applied for a job and, you know, the committee that was reviewing, which I was on, was comparing her, she does transgender research, to other traditional researchers and saying, look how many grants she has. And NIH, last year, I went and I looked to bring back to them, out of 25,000 grants that they funded, they had two that were on transgender health that weren't HIV related. And this person was being compared to someone doing autism research. Right. And I could not, for the life of me, get the committee to understand that if they're going to look at this transgender researcher, they have to look at them at a different way. And they didn't get the job. Mm-hmm. So it's just, I see people struggling today. Mm-hmm. So I don't know where we are.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that I'm most pleased about the last stages of my career is that I was on the organizing committee of a successful unionizing drive of the faculty on my campus. It should happen on every campus, and it especially needs to be supported for the non-tenure track people, because our contract really made a difference in their wages. And then the other thing, though, I mean, Anne, in terms of the sort of the insecurity that we're all living with, is, but I have to say, this is one of the great things about living, one of the potential benefits to living in this online world is that, you know, like, out history, many, and I'm really backward in this area, and many of the other sort of online sites, there are possibilities for putting history and other things out there into the world that aren't dependent on the structure of the profession, of the professions. So, and like, we really, I mean, need to take advantage of the virtual possibilities that are out there.
Okay, we have room for maybe one last question. Anybody? And then we'll turn
it
over.
Maybe some young, younger generation.
Not to put anyone on the spot.
Yeah, but I'd love to hear.
There's Beck there.
I'm 45. Does that?
You look younger.
That's younger.
Does that count? Hi, I'm Heather Love. Thank you so much for this amazing panel. And I just wanted to second what Amber said about my gratitude for your guys' sacrifices. But I guess I also, you know, I'm definitely of the generation where I got a job teaching queer studies out of graduate school. So I'm part of the creepy professionalization. But I think I just feel like it's important to complicate some of these really stark oppositions between, you know, the AHA and community spaces, or the bad old days and the new times. I mean, I think Anne's comment really speaks to that, to how much continuity there is for so many people. And that's partly about the structure of the profession and the economy, but it's also about this field and the incomplete institutionalization of this field, which is glamorous, but there's not enough infrastructure. And even for those of us who have great jobs and have been really lucky and have inherited from you guys, you know, we're still, frankly, working our asses off trying to make up for some very big structural gaps. So I think it's more complicated than that kind of opposition would suggest. And I think, you know, I haven't had the history of struggle and sacrifice that you guys had. In fact, I've benefited directly from that history. And also, you know, I don't really have to run into the fire in the same way. It's just a different, I'm in a different context. But I think what I have inherited would be like the critical spirit that of the work that you guys did. And
Great. And
I feel like, yes, there's online worlds, but I also think like the university is a workplace and that we are doing work through teaching, like hundreds and hundreds of students. And I feel like, you know, we're also, those of us doing critical work in the academy now are kind of facing down like a huge diversity industry, basically, which like I actually don't think we agree with a lot of the values and goals of that, and that, you know, it's sort of through the really the curiosity and the passion and the commitment of your work is what, and the intellectual passion that I think that I feel like I'm the direct inheritor of, and that's what I feel like I try to bring out in my teaching. And I guess I just feel like teaching is a space that, you know, is a very differential, uneven space. We're all positioned very differently in it. But that is the real world that I work in. And that is kind of what I see as the kind of afterlife, I guess, of a kind of, that is a community space, I guess, is what I want to say. In a complicated and uneven way. But I, anyway, so just to try to put, that's just my perspective on this question. I just want to break down some of those really, I think, two stark oppositions between, you know, this elite academy and community spaces. I think we live in a much more variegated, complicated. The more you know about it, the more complicated it is. I really agree with that. So thank you.
So let's give our panelist one last round of applause. And please keep that applause going for our coordinators, to Daniel, to Claire.
Pink too.
Yeah, we would just a couple minutes, and the panelists can go wherever they want to go. First of all, we would like to, actually, I would like to say somebody else who isn't here. Lisa Dugan was supposed to be on this panel, and Lisa, I think, is probably one of the brightest minds of my generation, so her spirit is with us, too. I'd like to thank Susan Stryker for setting the tone with an amazing keynote. Thank you, my sister. Really awesome. I would also like to say, in this university as a workspace, and I'm so proud to have had this at the new school, there's a lot of invisible labor that made this happen. There is the people who set up and break down this room. There are the people, I'm sure you saw them a couple times a day, emptying the trash cans. There are the caterers. There are the guards that kept the music students from walking away with all of our booze. There is a great deal of labor in this house that made this conference happen, so I would like to thank them too.
It's the mode of production.
The mode of production. I would like to thank Jonathan for being my friend, and John D'Amelio for being my friends. We've really, in working together, it's been wonderful getting to know you guys better. And finally, I'd like to thank Daniel, whose idea this was, as Jonathan said. Daniel wrote a wonderful grant to Arcus to make it happen.
All the way from Australia, he made this conference happen.
So, Daniel, come back soon. Fun things happen when you're here. And finally, I would like to thank you, the audience. I cannot tell you how many of you came up to me during these 3 days to ask how you could help, what you could do, to say thank you, to say you were having a good time. The spirit of this enterprise has really been awesome. So Give yourselves a round of applause, and then Daniel just has a couple of closing remarks.
Thanks, Claire. Claire and I hadn't met each other until last week, so I really want to thank Claire. I'm going to list a range of people, and then you could just give a round of applause, and we can go to drink the booze that didn't get stolen. obviously I want to acknowledge, this panel of pioneers that we had, that was incredible, and I really want to thank Claire for all of her work. Organizing a conference, it might be hard to believe across two different countries when you haven't met the person. We learned a whole range of new skills, so I recommend it to you if you haven't tried that already. And I really want to thank John D'Amelio also for his counsel, in relation to this idea. Kevin Nadal, bringing Clags on board was wonderful, and so we're very grateful for all of Kevin Nadal's work and his enthusiasm. Again, these are people who I hadn't met before the conference, so it's been a conference built on technology. And at the New School, as Claire suggested, we couldn't have pulled this event together without the hard work of many people. And Kevin Ewing isn't here because I believe he is already over at the other place doing other work. So when you see him over there, please, please pass on your thanks. I know some of you already have done that. And people like Brandon Fisher and Emma Becker and Alexander Fine and Chris and all the volunteers here, please give them a round of applause. I really appreciate all of your work. Brett Silvers as well. At Clags, we also really appreciated Yasmina Sinanovic's work and Christopher Adam Mitchell's help. The wonderful program committee, some of the program committee are here. Please give the program committee a round of applause. We had so many contributions to this conference. People wanted to be part of the conversation. We really appreciated all of their work. As Jonathan said, we couldn't have had food, etc., without the Arcus Foundation. They've provided so much money, so we're so grateful to them for all of their work, especially Kevin Jennings, Leah Parafax, and Monica Charles, and people at the Fund for the City of New York, including Sarah Kwok. Really want to also acknowledge, as Claire said, the facilities and catering staff who have helped us to do this event, and Susan's keynote did start the conversation for us yesterday in the perfect way. I remember sitting in Jonathan's kitchen and going, oh, wouldn't it be amazing if Susan Stryker would be the keynote? So that was really, has been amazing for us. It's been blown away by all of the presenters who have taken the time to come and have this conversation that we've had over the last 2.5 days about 40 years of gay American history, where we've thought about generations, inheritance, legacies, and what these things mean after 40 years of gay American history, because I don't think it can be denied that that these notions of generations, legacies, and inheritance can be the same now, 40 years on. We've changed what those things mean. So I want you to thank all of the presenters, especially those people who've traveled. All of you who have come, I know some of you have come from overseas. You've all made the conversation work. And lastly, I want to thank Jonathan for being kind of brave enough to let us do this thing, and because it might not have worked, so please thank you all and enjoy the party.